Okay, so maybe now the András, who is our next speaker, can start it. Yeah. Okay, maybe we'll wait one moment before the recording starts. Okay, I think we are actually recording. Okay, so I'm happy to announce our next speaker, András Gilyén, who will talk about result by Matt Hastings and Umesh Vazirani, sub-exponential advantage of adiabatic computation with no sign problem. Take it away, András.
Thank you for the introduction, Barbara. Yes, this is joint work with Matt Hastings and Umesh Vazirani. And really, this talk is about is a combination of two papers. And the first paper is by Matt, who showed how to achieve a super polynomial advantage by adiabatic computation without sign problem. And then with Umesh, we extended some of his ideas and improved the result. And this is the result of these two papers together. So let me first briefly go over what are the main ideas behind the adiabatic quantum computation. So this is a model of quantum computation which utilizes a slowly changing Hamiltonian HS, where S is some parameter which changes from 0 to 1, let's say for simplicity. And the idea is that if this Hamiltonian changes very slowly, then the adiabatic evolution will map the initial ground state, psi 0, to the final ground state, psi 1, by approximately staying in the immediate ground state H, psi s of HS. So if one slowly changes the Hamiltonian, then this is accurately mapped, this initial ground state. And to see how slowly one shall change the Hamiltonian itself, it's useful to consider the energy levels of the Hamiltonian. And here I just plotted the three lowest energy levels of the Hamiltonian as a function of S. And so the key parameter in analyzing this adiabatic evolution is the spectral gap, which is the gap between the lowest, the ground state energy, and the next energy level. And it turns out that if you are doing this evolution slowly, which is polynomially slowly in terms of this this spectral gap, then actually this mapping is really accurate, and you will find the ultimate ground state starting from the initial ground state with this adiabatic evolution. So as it was shown by Aharonov et al., adiabatic quantum computation is an equivalent and universal model of quantum computation. So really, everything can be cast into an adiabatic quantum computation, and every adiabatic quantum computation can be efficiently performed on a quantum computer. So this is really an equivalent model. And why attention was drawn into this model is because it's a popular heuristic for combinatorial optimization. And one of the most common things to do is just to take the initial Hamiltonian to be something very simple. In this combinatorial optimization, very often it's a transferred field Hamiltonian, which is just a tensor product of X operators. And of course, we know what is the ground state of that, or like minus X to the tensor N. And the ground state of that is just the uniform superposition. And that's easy to prepare with some Hadamards or other ways. So we start with this well-known initial ground state, and then we slowly change this Hamiltonian linearly interpolating to HZ, which is a Hamiltonian that is diagonal in the computational basis because it's a classical Hamiltonian that describes the objective function in the combinatorial optimization problem that we wish to minimize. And well, there was initially high hope that this actually would solve many hard problems, but unfortunately for hard problems, it seems that the gap tends to become really small, exponentially small, or maybe even smaller than that. So actually this does not work in general, but maybe in some cases it can do something interesting. And one special case, which often is seen in practice and also the simple example that I showed you falls into this category, is when Hamiltonians have no sign problem during this evolution, which means that all off-diagonal matrix elements of HS are non-positive for every S. And note that this property is actually basis dependent, so it is considered in the, say, in computational basis where you work in. So this is an interesting and relevant case both for physics and for computer science. And because there are no sign problems, some people also call it stoquastic, that's just a different name. And there were hopes that maybe this is a classically tractable case. And why is it easier than the general case? Is that the lack of signs prevents destructive interference in the ground state, meaning that by the Perron-Frobenius theorem, we know that all amplitudes in the ground state have the same sign. They are all like non-negative numbers, these amplitudes. And that obviously is a simplification. It makes things easier. And it was also shown by Bravyi and Terhal that if the Hamiltonians are frustration-free, then the adiabatic evolution can actually efficiently simulate it on a classical computer, which is another indication that this is an easier case. And also from a physics side, often these systems which have no sign problem can be very nicely simulated remarkably well in practice with Monte Carlo methods. However, they are topological obstructions to path integral Monte Carlo, which is one of the most popular quantum Monte Carlo method as shown by Hastings and Friedman. And also diffusion Monte Carlo is sensitive to different obstructions, namely when the ground state has L1 and L2 weights placed differently. So maybe most of the L1 weight lies on some different part of the ground state than the most of the L2 weight. And if that's the case, then it seems that the diffusion Monte Carlo has a hard time actually dealing with these systems, even if there are no sign problems. And this was shown by Jared, Jordan, and Lackey in 2016. Okay, so there is some general hope that this is classically tractable, but there are also some problems with Monte Carlo methods. So what is the case? What is the power of this adiabatic evolution with no sign problem? And maybe let's be generous and say that it is also some large spectral gap so that we can handle the system. And let me explain a little bit more about the topological obstructions that Hastings and Friedman discovered, because it will be relevant for our construction. And here the main idea is that at a normal Monte Carlo algorithm would just do a random walk on the state space. And because we want to somehow capture the quantumness, we can use path integral Monte Carlo, which is abstractly is a random walk among paths. So now the new state space would be paths in the original state space, and we are just walking on paths, meaning that in a local update to this path integral Monte Carlo would be just growing, shrinking the paths, adding a few edges or so on. So that's the speed of path integral Monte Carlo. And what Hastings and Friedman observed, that long cycles that cannot be approximated by shorter cycles are problematic in this case. And what do I mean by approximating my shorter cycles is that maybe remove an edge and add two edges, and then you get a larger cycle, and you gradually grow your cycle to a longer one. And sometimes there are cycles that are not approachable that way. You need to jump a big to get there. For example, if you're a particle in a torus, then although you can draw lots of small cycles and grow them gradually on the surface of the torus, getting to a cycle which actually wraps around the torus is not possible this way because of this topological structure of the whole space. And in case of the torus, for example, people know how to fix this issue just by adding moves that add or remove long cycles across the torus. But in general, it was not known how to fix such issues. And so the question was still open. And this is where our result comes, and we finally settle this question, at least in an oracular setting. So we show that there is a family of sparse sign problem free Hamiltonians on n qubits with a straight adiabatic path that features also a polynomial large spectral gap, whose evolution requires somewhat sub-exponential but close to exponential number of queries to the Hamiltonian entries to simulate classically. So now it's in a query model. We really use oracles for this separation, and now we count the number of queries that are made to the Hamiltonian entries itself. That is our query model. It's like a sparse Hamiltonian access model, and we count the queries, and whereas the adiabatic evolution can be done using this Hamiltonian efficiently, any classical algorithm must make a very large number of queries to this Hamiltonian to have any sort of reasonable simulation of this adiabatic path. And one might not like that it's an oracle separation that we give, but the truth is that if we want to give some provable advantage between some computational models, really we don't have much more techniques than use some oracles or maybe reduce to some other complexity conjectures. So that's reasonable. I wanted to say a little bit about techniques. So how we get here is, in fact, we consider a graph problem. So our Hamiltonian just comes from the adjacency matrix of a sparse graph on 2^n vertices. And there, the specific task that the adiabatic algorithm can solve is that given the entrance vertex, we can find the exit vertex in polynomial time via this adiabatic evolution that corresponds to the Hamiltonian that is just minus times the adjacency matrix. And we show that this has a polynomial spectral gap, no sign problem. And at the same time, any classical algorithm that finds the exit vertex from the entrance vertex has to make this large number of queries. All right, so we actually show this by starting from a very simple graph. So I'm just telling you how we construct this graph, which has these properties. So we just first take a path graph of length L, where L is some polynomial of n, and we take the Hamiltonian to be minus the adjacency matrix of this path, and say that the entrance would be the first vertex and the exit would be the last vertex. And obviously it's very simple to find the exit in this graph, but we will make it more difficult later. So the adjacency matrix in this case is just the neighboring, the matrix elements will be non-zero for the neighboring vertices as shown here. And the simple Hamiltonian that we start with, the beginning of the adiabatic evolution will be simply a self-loop, a negative weight given to the entrance vertex. So that's H initial, and HL is the adjacency matrix, minus the adjacency matrix of this path graph. And so the simple adiabatic path that we use is just a linear interpolation between these two Hamiltonians. So we start with this initial Hamiltonian, which has the ground state, the entrance vertex, and then it shifted to the path. And the spectral gap, as we show, it's polynomial in L. And so, yeah, it's just really a linear interpolation. And the good thing is that once we shifted the Hamiltonian to the Hamiltonian of the path graph, then the ground state on this path will have a polynomial overlap with the exit vertex. So we find it with some reasonable probability. And in fact, we can also tweak slightly, add one more straight path to this evolution, and we can actually exactly transfer the ground state to the exit vertex. But then it's like two straight paths together, but already one straight path suffices actually in our case. Okay, so how can we make this actually difficult? Because the previous example was clearly easy to solve even classically. Well, now the first step in the construction is what we call obfuscation, where we take the initial graph and each vertex of this path graph we replace by a cluster of vertices. And in a way that at the beginning, at the end, we build some large trees. These trees will be expanding with every vertex having m square children in the graph. And so this initial and last section we call a funnel because of its shape. And in the middle, we just make these vertices blow up to clusters of the same size. And then between these clusters in the so-called tunnel part of the graph, we just add m random matchings between the neighboring clusters. And that will be the graph that we get, that is what is shown in the picture. And so it's kind of easy to see that if we reduce this graph to this subspace where each cluster is replaced by uniform superposition on that cluster, then actually in this subspace is invariant under this adjacency matrix. And in this subspace, actually we get a path graph which have now edge weights m everywhere. So it's like the original graph in this subspace, but every edge now has weight m, where m is some, again, some polynomial in n or l, large number. So it preserves the structure of the path graph on this subspace. But there is one problem that we might lose the gap. Maybe the ground state on this in the subspace, which remains like isomorphic to the original structure of the energies and the vectors in for the case of the path graph. Maybe when we consider all other possibilities and we step out of this symmetric subspace where everything becomes simple, maybe there are some other states that have energy very close to the ground state. So with this reduction, we could potentially lose the property that we have a gapped Hamiltonian. And to fix this, we additionally add some expander graphs on every cluster. I only drew here the expanders for three clusters, but it should be really everywhere. And what it adds, that it really emphasizes that this symmetric subspace has much lower energy than everything else. So in particular, the ground state within this symmetric subspace will have way lower energy than everything outside this subspace. And then this trick restores the gap. And another additional feature is that, well, with these random cycles and these random expanders that we added to the graph, now we have very long cycles that look very confusing and are hard to find. So in a way, this step kind of tricks path integral Monte Carlo. And intuitively, If someone wants to go from the entrance to the exit, when gets to the middle section, the tunnel, then someone just gets lost. It's no longer clear when you start walking in the tunnel which cluster you are in. Maybe you made a step forward, maybe way backwards, and you get lost. So that's why it's a more difficult graph. But actually, it's easy to see that a simple random walk, if you just like close your eyes and try to get through the tunnel without knowing where you are, if you don't worry about it, just do it long enough, you will get to the other end of the funnel and still you can find the exit. So there is an algorithm which can penetrate and go through this graph, but it's already more difficult than it was before. So it's a good step in the harness. Oh yeah, and just a note that these expander graphs that we add on these clusters basically can be like represented as like some self loops attached to every vertex in this path, and that doesn't really change any of the spectral properties. So it's not a problem. And then there is another second step, which is called decoration. And this is where things get more difficult, even more difficult. And in this step, we just add some trees of some relatively higher depth to every vertex. And that, especially in the tunnel, will make things very difficult for any algorithm. So we attach these camouflage or decoration trees to every vertex, and several of those, in fact, to every vertex in the graph. And each attached tree has a degree bound of order m. So every vertex in these new trees will have at most m order m neighbors. And for that reason, the spectral norm of each tree or the adjacency matrix of it has order square root m, and also the entire forest that we attach together has a spectral norm bound of order square root m. So in fact, we don't perturb the spectrum by too much, and the spectral gap before decoration is something like m over l square, because l square was the spectral gap originally, and we just scaled up the graph by a factor m. And from this, one can show that if square root m is much larger than l square, then the spectral gap cannot close under this perturbation, which only represents order square root m perturbation to the spectrum. So we just choose the parameters so that it is satisfied. And because we choose this perturbation such, m and the ratio of m and l satisfying this, the ground state will suffer only a minor perturbation in terms of the L2 norm. However, if the trees that we add are at least polynomially deep in M, then the L1 weight in the ground state, which is now perturbed, will move the trees. So if we look at the ground state this with an L2 glass, then you don't see major difference. But if you would look at this ground state with an L1 mindset, then you would see a huge difference. Most of the weight is actually transferred to the trees. And as I indicated before, this L1 to L2 discrepancy in the ground state actually makes diffusion Monte Carlo have a hard time. Okay, so now we have a graph which is still adiabatically behaving nicely. It has a small gap. It has a relatively large gap, and it's a stochastic, sign problem free, because it's just a weighted graph with positive weights. However, we didn't trick every algorithm yet, so that's the next step. And so first, let's understand what are the algorithms that still can work on this graph. And one can see that if the attached trees have all the same depth, then we can efficiently filter them out and basically remove them with the following simple argument. After traversing an edge, we can perform a non-backtracking trial walk. And if a leaf is found after these steps, then we know that the camouflage tree was entered. And then we just know that we should not do this step of entering this camouflage tree, and then we can restore walking on the original graph. And so basically we removed all these dangling trees, and then we can solve the problems before using a random walk. And the trick to prohibit such algorithms is to attach these trees which have a very confusing fractal shape. So these trees are designed in such a way that the expected hitting time of leaves barely changes while moving deeper into a tree. So previously, if you had the trees have the same depth always, then if you go deeper into a tree, then it's, you always reach a leaf with d minus one steps and d minus two. So it's very easy to recognize that you went deeper in the tree. However, if this graph, if this tree has a fractal shape that we design, then you can barely notice any change while you walk deeper in this tree, and you will just have no way to recognize when you enter this camouflage or decoration tree. And as we showed, due to the random labeling of vertices, actually no classical algorithm can navigate these decorated trees, and any classical algorithm will get lost, spending an exponential amount of time in the camouflage trees before finding the exit. So this is how we defeat every algorithm. So this was a brief discussion of how our construction work, and I hope that I gave some intuition why this is a sensible idea to make, to do. And I just want to mention a few open questions at the end. And obviously the first open question is to find a sign problem free Hamiltonian of practical interest, providing large speed up. But then there are some other fundamental questions left open. For example, are sign problem free Hamiltonians at least marginally easier in general? So for example, is there a general simulation algorithm that works in runtime, say square root 2 to the n? Remember that our algorithm, our example showed that classical algorithm needs at least something like fifth root of 2 to the n, versus 2 to the n would be the hardest possible that one could imagine. Now, there is still a hope that maybe a slightly sub-exponential algorithm exist in general. But actually, what is even more widely open, the question of what is the classical complexity of simulating adiabatic evolution for frustrated local Hamiltonians with no sign problem. So our Hamiltonian is non-local, but if you have a local Hamiltonian which is also frustration-free, then you have a classical algorithm as shown by Bravyi et al. But the interesting intermediate question is, what happens if you have a local Hamiltonian which is frustrated? Well, maybe there is still a classical algorithm that can utilize the local structure, or maybe there is no. So that's a wide open question. And some results of Bringvat and Jarrett, actually from last year, show that the kind of tricks, the subspace hiding, that is the core to many hardest results in the non-local and local Hamiltonians for this problem, actually don't really work for local Hamiltonians. So one avenue of showing hardness, which is the main avenue used in our work, seems to fail for local Hamiltonians. So it's very interesting to see what's happening here, and I would like to close my talk with this.
Okay, thank you, András, for a very fascinating, interesting talk. Great results. Let me relay a few questions from the audience. David Gossett asks, this was when you explained these graphs, why does the tunnel need to have linear size in L? It seems that this is a modification to the original glue trees example.
Yes, it is in a way a modification of the glue trees examples. But so one thing is very important that we should have in the reduced symmetric subspace. The graph should look like that every edge should have the same weight. And in the glue trees example, everything has the same weight, except in the middle, you have a square root two, like a larger weight in the middle. And that just makes the ground state exponentially decay towards the ends. And that is obviously problematic because the entrance and the exit that you care about and the exponentially small overlap with that is problematic. And so the glue trees example uses the fact that every vertex has the same degree, maybe except from the entrance and exit, and that makes it everyone very lost. But you know, as a consequence, in the middle, somehow you have a higher weight in the reduced space, and that we can't afford. So therefore, in our construction, in the funnel, you have larger degrees. So every vertex have m square children, and in the tunnel, you only have m neighbors with these matchings. And that makes it possible for a random walker to recognize when it reaches the funnel. And that means that if you had no tunnel at all, you could just walk through it because you would notice when you are in the middle, And if you have only the ability to recognize when you are in the middle, you can already pass through the glue trees example. Actually, this is what we showed in our other paper where we showed some property testing hardness for the glue trees and related problems. That is a key insight that if you can just recognize in the glue trees example when you are in the middle, that already enables you to go through the entire graph. So now you can recognize when you reach the end of the funnel, and we still want to make it very difficult for you to go through the entire graph. And for that, we need to make this tunnel section longer because that's the only place where we can make you lost. So basically the tunnel is where you get lost, and the funnel is somehow understandable for every walker.
Okay, thanks, András. Here's another question from Seva Caribbean. How did the construction evolve from Matt's work to your work with Vazirani? Could you highlight the difference? And I agree with, I find this question interesting. Also the proof that classical algorithm has to have, you know, many queries, because that result seems slightly different. And yeah.
So the core idea of the hardness is really from Matt's paper. This he phrased it differently, but this fractal shaped trees, that is this decoration trees, that is the key ingredient of the hardness proof of his paper. And that is, we just take that ingredient, but we tweak it a little bit. So we somehow make the trees have a different shape and a different, like they are kind of deeper, but they have less children or something like that. And this makes the hardness go from quasi-polynomial to sub-exponential. So that's the part that we tweak to get this sub-exponential hardness. And the other things are just making this construction look more similar to the glue trees and explaining differences and similarities. In particular, to get from one vertex to the other, there are some non-trivial reductions in Matt's paper, and we just simplify that. So we have a simplified backbone, which is these glue trees, and then the essential ingredients for the hardness, which is the fractal shaped trees, we tweak that as well.
Okay, thanks, András. I think any further questions can be asked in the roundtables, which will start now. So please go to the roundtables. And as a reminder, also at 5:45, you can have your picture taken with other people. And we really need everybody's picture taken. So if you haven't done that already, go over there. And you can also join Jake and Betta at 6 at the roundtable. Okay, thanks for all the speakers for this session.